Allora, ho dimenticato di dire che Inherent Vice è candidato come miglior sceneggiatura originale, pardon, e per i costumi. È la sesta nomination personale, diciamo, per regia o per sceneggiatura di Paul Thomas Anderson, vero? Settimo film, sei candidature. Abbiamo la simultanea, quindi adesso oggi. Ci siamo?
Oh God, I think so. Yeah, that sounds right.
No. Six nomination.
Yeah, yeah. Well, yes, that sounds right. I don't remember.
No, no, I'm sure. I checked.
Okay, good.
Settimo film, e per caso ha per questo film scelto di adattare il settimo romanzo di Thomas Fincham. Il 7 è un numero ricorrente, adesso lo dico tanto per scaldare un po', ma poi passerò alla domanda. Il 7 è un numero ricorrente, è nato nel 1970, esattamente l'anno in cui si svolge Inherent Vice, e è anche l'unico che ricordo negli ultimi anni che ha girato un film in 70 mm, destando un po' di caos a Hollywood.
I should go to the races, you know, and bet on the number seven horse in the seventh race. I like that, you know. That's, I don't know, I believe in that stuff a little bit. When you say it, it sounds real to me. Very authentic.
Allora, io non ho la traduzione, ma non fa niente, ho capito? Va bene, adesso la sento. Partiamo dal punto. Io farò due domande, poi sono sicura che ci sono molte domande dal pubblico e quindi ce ne aspettiamo davvero molte. Però solo lei non si è spaventato leggendo Vizio di forma e pensando di farne un film? Perché francamente è veramente un romanzo difficile, molto difficile da adattare. Vorrei sapere come ci ha lavorato, ma anche perché proprio Vizio di forma, perché proprio questo romanzo di Pynchon, che cosa?
Because I had thought about trying to do other Thomas Pynchon books, by the time this one arrived it actually seemed much easier than the other one, as difficult as it was. I like the idea that it was his most recent book. That it was, here's a writer who's in his late 70s and is still looking back at a time that was obviously very important to him. And it seemed very possible to do. As difficult as it was, it seemed like a good, fertile ground for a story. Did you get that? Am I talking too much?
No. Continue.
Okay.
Go on.
Right, good.
So, how did you work on this book?
Well, you know, honestly, I just took the book and I got a cookbook holder, you know, that opens up, and I typed it all out as a script, because that was the only way I could figure out how to do it. I didn't, when I first read a Thomas Pynchon book, to me everything is important and nothing can go. So I was very precious about it, and then at a certain point I realized that, you know, the script was like that thick, and it needed to get like that, and you just keep working with it, and start collaborating with the actors, and little by little it gets to a place where you all feel comfortable.
E Thomas Pynchon l'ha sentito? Ci ha parlato? Thomas Pynchon, come sapete, non lo vede nessuno, ma...
Nobody sees Thomas Pynchon. Nobody.
Not you?
Me? No, no. We have to just leave it how it is, I think, which is that he's decided that he doesn't want his photograph taken, he doesn't want to do interviews, he only wants the work to speak for itself, which is a very respectable thing, and I have so much respect for that, that's just how it should be. It's a wonderful way to work, I think. Like, directors should never talk, you know, they just end up saying stupid things.
E allora non è vera la storia che c'è un cameo di Thomas Pynchon nel film?
No, that's just a story.
Sure.
Any confusion that you put out there about Thomas Pynchon is good.
Allora, avrei ancora una cosa da chiedere prima di scatenare il pubblico. L'ultima, diciamo, il film si chiude su una frase. Scusate, sento solo la traduzione in inglese. Quindi, si chiude su una frase: siamo sott'acqua. Siamo, we are underwater, alone underwater. Io ho l'impressione che lei abbia girato il film come se fosse sott'acqua, anche da un punto di vista del lavoro di fotografia. È solo una mia impressione oppure è quello che voleva? Come se fosse un po' fumato, diciamo, ecco, per il film.
Yeah, you know, I love that, the way that you described that. And I can't say that it was something that I intended or I thought about, but I love that description. I think if you've ever spent enough time at the beach, you know, people that normally live by the beach are people like Doc sometimes. They're kind of, or sometimes my kids go to sleep and they have a wave machine. They put in a wave machine and it kind of lulls them. It makes them feel very calm. And maybe that explains it, you know. There's something, people that live at the beach live at a different rhythm than people that live in the city. Maybe that has to do with it. But I like the way you described.
Che cosa esattamente le interessa di quest'epoca, l'epoca hippie, che poi è la fine dell'epoca hippie nel suo film? È l'epoca dopo Charlie Manson?
Yeah.
La affascina quell'epoca o no?
I was not particularly fascinated with it too much before I read the book. I'm more fascinated by other periods that naturally might, you know, have music or fashion or something like that that's interesting to me. But this one became more interesting after I read the book. But the idea of films or stories that are set in transitional periods is always usually pretty good. You know, you usually there's something interesting going on where something is ending or some dream has been diminished. That usually you can get good stories out of that thing that happens. I've talked about this before, that when I was growing up, when you would hear your parents or somebody moan about the 60s, it was irritating because it was your parents moaning about something. But reading the book or thinking a little bit more about it or researching it more helped me understand what they were moaning about, which was a kind of loss of a certain kind of innocence or a kind of a dream that they had, a hippie dream that they had that never really came true. So it became a bit more poignant than just, you know, people saying, oh, the 60s, they were so cool, you know, that kind of thing. Well, I had seen Catherine in a very small film on television, and I thought she was terrific. She had all the qualities that were good. She's talented, beautiful. She looks very, she looks like she's from that period, you know, with her body and her face. And the scene that you're talking about was very close to the book. I mean, I think that the way that we worked on it was that I had written a version of it from the script, and she had the book, and she looked at what I had written, and we went back and forth and just took the pieces from the book that we liked, that she liked, and we rearranged them, and she made it so that she was comfortable with the scene. And, you know, it was really, all the credit goes to her for how she kind of navigated it and did it. I honestly didn't say very much at all. She just sort of did it and put the camera in the right place.
That's important.
Yeah, that helps, but you can put the camera in the right place and film something kind of uninteresting and